All right, I'll go ahead and get started. So here we are. Where are we? So week six. So today we're going to talk about transportation engineering. And then on Wednesday, we've got our alumni roundtable. So our alumni roundtable, I've invited four alumni. I think they graduated around 2019 to come in and speak. We've got four alumni, variety of disciplines, kind of a, you know, talk a little bit about their experiences, where they work, kind of give a little intro, and then I've got just like a list of kind of roundtable questions that we'll kind of work through time allowed. There'll be an opportunity for questions and answers at the end. And then based on that alumni roundtable, you have an alumni roundtable paper, just kind of a reflection. And so it'll be kind of maybe similar somewhat to the Bridge collapse paper in that you'll start off with kind of a summary of we had these four speakers, you know, these were their careers, this is what they talked about, and then you'll have a reflection on that where you offer your insights, like what were you most interested in, things of that nature. So I'll post more details about that alumni roundtable paper probably by tomorrow, so you'll have that as a guide. But certainly you'll want to, you know, attend that for your own interest, as well as, you know, take notes so you can use those as you write the paper. And so this week, so that'll be happening Wednesday. You've got some reading, and you'll have another quiz this week. And then next week will be maybe similar to a couple weeks ago, where we'll take a pause on the reading, and you'll have your alumni roundtable paper, and then presentation next week, so it'll be a busy week as far as that goes. So, any questions about that schedule? Feel free if you want to bring, you know, Halloween costumes on Wednesday, that's fine. Whatever you want to do. Okay, there we go. So, transportation engineering. So we're continuing to move through the disciplines. I think I've got this one, and then construction engineering next week, and then we'll kind of wrap up the disciplines and talk about some more general overarching themes. So learning objectives here for transportation. This comes from both the notes, discussion today, and the reading. List five modes of transportation and describe the history of their evolution. Identify the four project stages for transportation projects. So I've got, you know, the outline or the slides today kind of follow along those four stages. And those stages certainly are applicable for transportation, but they're all kind of sort of general for civil as well. And we'll talk a lot about just the types of projects, some of the challenges. So just be able to describe at least three challenges transportation engineers face in your area. So, what do people think when we talk about transportation engineering? What comes to mind? Sure.
Roads and railways, and bike lanes,
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The signs.
Signs. Yeah, directions. Sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah, all that's true. I mean, like, we all got here somehow, right? So some of us walked, some of us biked, some of us drove, some of us flew, who, you know, however you got here. And so all those are forms of transportation. And so certainly it's applicable to, you know, human transportation. Also, so the broader sense, just our economy. You know, our economy is based on movement of goods and services to get to people so they can buy things and things of that nature. So all that sort of ties in to transportation. So for definition, transportation engineering is the application of technology, scientific principles, planning, design, construction, operation. And so those are your four stages there, the planning, the design, the construction, and operation. So we design these systems. We want them to be safe, efficient, equitable, and sustainable. So I think when we talk about transportation, it's good to sort of talk about and just kind of reflect on how much things have changed. Yeah, so this is a picture of New York City downtown, 1900, so 130, 120 years ago. So lots of people, lots of commerce, still a bustling city, but it's horse and buggy. You know, so trains existed. If you were going like, you know, cross country, you certainly could sort of do trains, moving of goods between, you know, larger distances were that. But largely on a day-to-day basis, people walked, people biked, people got around on horse and buggies. And that was, you know, horses, you know, certainly if you're in the rural area, working on farms, you know, horses, things of that nature. So the modes and the way and the reasons and the frequency people traveled, you know, was very different just based on the technology means that we had at our disposal in that time frame. So from 1900, you know, the Model T, first sort of mass-produced car was produced. That was became available in 1908. With the Model T, all of a sudden, the idea was that we make a car that's cheap enough for the average person. So it wasn't just like the rich that could afford it, maybe average family could sort of afford it. And then, you know, that opened up a whole slew of possibilities and a whole slew of problems associated with that. But one of the things that did is that all of a sudden people started using cars not just, you know, to get from point A to point B, but it was like, oh, this pleasure pursuit. And, you know, now we can go to visit friends or we can go to see scenery. And so the Columbia River Historic Highway that, you know, starts in Troutdale, sort of goes out through the gorge. It was one of the first scenic highways. It was built largely just for that pleasure pursuit, driving to sort of go out and see some beautiful scenery outside of Portland. Okay, so this chart, I think, is fascinating. So what we've got going on, we've got two charts. A little blow up of this detail is right here that you can kind of look at. And the black line along all these charts is for the U.S. number of vehicles per 1,000 people. And so, you know, turn of the century, horse and buggy, pretty much no one has cars. You know, cars start to be produced a little bit, maybe just the rich could afford it. Right here, 1908, that's when the Model T is invented and becomes available. And then here in about 17 years from that adoption, you know, the U.S. already were up at 175 vehicles per 1,000 people. And our crazy rise sort of continues. We've got a bit of a dip here during World War II with that effect on the economy and everything, but then, you know, it picks back up. And so right here, right around 2010, we're roughly at 850 vehicles per 1,000 people. So nearly a 1-to-1 in our country, which is kind of crazy. And the other data points we have on this are where other countries fall on this with their associated date. So for example, right here, Brazil in 2008, you know, was less than 150, maybe 140 cars, just 10, you know, 14 years ago. If we look at, Western Europe, 2008, 600 cars. So, you know, certainly up there, but a good percent less than us. We've got Asia, 2008, down here, about 55 cars per 1,000 people. And so, I just think it's really fascinating to kind of reflect on that and think about, you know, the U.S. experience of cars, that dynamic that's transpired over the last 100 plus years as far as the transportation sector, but then also to kind of reflect on how our experience is a little different and a little unique than most of the rest of the world. And, you know, largely like some of these other countries on our chart here are developing and we've been a model on a lot of fronts for the rest of the world, but some of the things as far as the our car trajectory, you know, isn't necessarily the model that I think we want to the world to reflect on, at least from a sustainability standpoint. So, with this sort of background as far as cars, you know, for the last 100 years in U.S., the vast majority of transportation effort has been focused on transportation for cars. So we had, you know, right around the 40s after World War II, you know, we passed the infrastructure bill and, you know, built all our interstate highway system, and, you know, just our more and more and more our development, our infrastructure, our resources that we put into have been sort of focused on that sort of car-centric environment. So something else that's fascinating. So Model T, first car, right? Should be very simple, basic, old school technology. What do you think the fuel mileage for that car was?
50 miles a gallon.
It was about 20 miles a gallon. But in 120 some years, you look at the average like fuel mileage, like we're just about the same. And you think about the advances in technology over the last 120 years, and we've not made any significant improvements on that. It's kind of shocking. So I think there's, you know, lots of reasons for that. Lots of documentaries out there to kind of touch upon those. Okay, but so even though, you know, the vast majority of our transportation effort in our country has been focused on cars, certainly transportation and the modern transportation engineering discipline is very much focused on a much broader scale. So we're looking at mass transportation, so buses, trains, other ways to move people, you know, certainly bike facilities, encouraging that. You know, here in Portland, we're pretty fortunate to have a very diverse options. We've got sort of aerial tram in there, and, you know, Tilikum Bridge, you know, it's one of the first, if not only, major bridge built in the U.S. in the last while that, you know, is not built for cars. So we have some unique experiences in Portland, and to be blatantly honest, that's one of the things that drew me to Portland. After living in other parts of the U.S., the sort of more progressive transportation infrastructure here was very much an attraction. It's a bit of a culture shock for me. I moved from Atlanta to Portland. I don't know if anyone's been to Atlanta, but Atlanta, like their version of I-5, is about 8 lanes in each direction. So you've got like this 16-lane highway, and that's like all over the place. You know, they got I-5, they got, well, not I-5, it's I-75 there. And, you know, they're Banfield and everything, but it's suburban sprawl to the extreme. Okay, so why is transportation engineering so important to society? What are some thoughts you can think of why this is important? Sure. Yeah, just from an economic standpoint, people are employed business-wise. The easier and cheaper it is to do that, the more profitable your business could be. Sure, that's part of it.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, like cities growing, you gotta have ways for those people to move around. So like if you plan has to kind of allow for increase.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Mm-hmm.
The whole economy increases and then job increase as the whole society more accessible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, all those are very, very important reasons. Yeah, some figures to kind of look at here. One reason, another reason, is just that we spend a lot of time moving from place to place. And if you look just at commute time to get to work, you know, here's a little chart. So up here in the red, that's roughly kind of an hour plus round trip commute for the week. You know, the lighter blue green would be less than half hour round trip times. And so pretty much all the big sort of metro areas, you're looking at an hour plus time. And this is just commute for work. You know, most people are traveling not just for work. You're like going out to get groceries, going out to pick up your kids, take them to school, you know. So people spend significant amounts every single day moving from place to place. And so the infrastructure that we have, the transportation options you have available, influence that. And the impacts that that has is a couple fold. You know, one, there's just a safety aspect. That if we're moving so much in our society, that if our infrastructure is safe, then we can do it, you know, without having accidents. And the costly impacts or, you know, health impacts of what an accident might be. And so there are significant accidents and deaths and fatalities in the U.S. every single year. So that's a big negative. Another one is just the cost associated with it. Transportation infrastructure is expensive. And second biggest expense after housing. And when you look at the options as far as how to get from point A to point B, by far the most expensive option is driving a personal automobile. So if you have the infrastructure in place to be able to take a bus, take a bike, take anything other mode, it's going to be vastly cheaper. But because of the car-focused development throughout our country, yeah, there are many communities throughout the U.S. that there aren't a lot of other options for a lot of individuals. And so it kind of forces that expense to the forefront. Whoops. And then also just looking at it from a sustainability standpoint, you know, we talked in the environmental sector about air pollution and the impacts of that. But, you know, from greenhouse gases, from global warming, from just the exposure of toxic chemicals, from the burning of fossil fuels, from the smog, from cars, etc. You know, all of those have huge sustainability impacts and just health impacts to our communities. So for all those reasons, transportation is really, really important. Okay, I got a short little video here talking about some of the work transportation engineers do.
New York is a great city, very large, 8 to 9 million people in the metropolitan area, and of those 8 or 9 million, about 600,000 come into and out of the city every working day.
Whether you live here, you come in to commute here for work, or whether you're just visiting, they all rely on the city's infrastructure system, which is one of the oldest in the country.
One of the great things about New York is that it's diverse culturally, and it's always growing.
Solutions for transit that have been implemented in the past can no longer meet the needs for current urban environments. As a result, systems need to be improved and need to be expanded, and this is where Parsons comes in.
We look at every aspect of the city's infrastructure, every mode of transport, and we are involved in trying to make the most out of it.
One of the goals we have now with any infrastructure project is not only just to improve something and to rehabilitate it, but to make it last. Many of our customers now have life cycles to go 150 or 200 years. And here at Parsons, we're here to meet that challenge. And fortunately, we have the capacity here in New York City to make that happen.
So with an aging infrastructure and an increasing population, innovation is the key.
When you combine all the technology that Parsons is working on and all the infrastructure needs of a modern, large urban center, you get a growing and thriving city, a city that's not only efficient, but safe.
There's a lot of work to do. The government recognizes that, and now we're really making some big strides into really improving the infrastructure.
At Parsons, it's our continued goal to deliver solutions that help people move into and out of the city as quickly, safely, and efficiently as possible. As a result, we look forward to a bright future in New York City.
So that obviously was a marketing, you know, marketing video from Parsons, but just sort of highlighted their transportation work they're doing in New York there. So a couple things I want to touch upon just as far as the video. You know, one is that the transportation discipline is really interdisciplinary. And I'd say when you look at the spectrum of disciplines within civil engineering, transportation probably is more so than some of the others. And it's just because the industry of the transportation sector and all that infrastructure has such broad impacts across all of society. And so any project that's undertaking has lots of different layers to it. There's always going to be a big sort of public outreach component because we're designing facilities for the public, understanding their needs, and you know, that whole sort of planning side here. The four stages for your typical transportation project, you've got planning, design, construction, and then operation and maintenance. So on this planning side in particular, you've got a really diverse profession. And so in a transportation engineering office, you'll have a lot of non-engineers working in all these sectors, but particularly for planning. And so I highlight that partly because that can be a big draw for some individuals, because having a more diverse office environment and a more diverse sort of workforce interacting with a lot of different sort of disciplines and types of people can just give a different flavor to your day in, day out type of activities that can be very attractive for some. Okay, so I'm going to talk about each one of these sort of stages a little bit in depth. So on that planning side, you know, for us to look at a system, so let's talk about Portland. You know, we're talking about our infrastructure here in Portland. We've got our existing baseline as far as our roads, our bridges, our bus lines, our rail infrastructure, all that kind of stuff. And we want to sort of look at it and assess it, figure out, well, what needs to change? What do we need to improve? What do we need to develop? And that sort of long scale range, you know, that's the work that the planners are working on. And you know, this largely is driven from a municipality standpoint. So like the city of Portland is ultimately the client here. They are the ones that are making the decisions. But generally speaking, most cities, even though they employ some transportation engineers at the city level, the effort involved in this planning with all this sort of data acquisition and consideration alternatives is really a substantial effort. And so they usually hire out to engineering firms to do that work. So when they're doing that work, you know, they're looking at that. They're wanting to sort of collect a lot of data. You know, so for you to all these ideas and solutions that we're going to present on the engineering level are grounded in numbers. And so we got to sort of figure out, well, what's, you know, let's collect the data, see who's traveling where, why they're traveling, how do they travel. And so we have the baseline as far as what the current status quo is. And then we kind of come up with some visions as far as, well, what do we want the status quo to be? And, you know, what's our vision for 20, 30 years from now? And then we're going to look at different alternatives for that. And these kind of solutions are kind of simultaneously happening on the big overall view where we're looking at on the city level. What's the whole sort of system infrastructure that we ideally want to have 10, 20, 30 years from now, as well as looking at on a specific, you know, road by road, bridge by bridge, intersection by intersection scenario where we're looking at, okay, we've got a lot of accidents happening at this intersection. What can we do to improve that, improve the safety so that we minimize those accidents? And so we look at alternatives for all our options. So to highlight some alternatives here, along NATO Parkway, so right along the waterfront. We've got Waterfront Park kind of over here. We've got, you know, downtown Portland here, NATO Parkway running this way. And so the status quo, probably 6 years ago or so, whether we had two northbound lanes, two southbound lanes, bike lanes for each direction. And that created problems, particularly in the summer months, because in the summer months, we have lots of events going on at Waterfront Park. Those events often have sort of fencing, sort of blocking it off, you know, because we've got certain entrances where you can go into Cinco de Mayo or whatever the event is. And then because you've got fencing here, it's all blocked off, people can't walk through the park. And so then people sort of spill out into the bike lane spill out into the roads. It just presented lots of conflict and lots of safety concerns for pedestrians, bikers, motorists, all sorts of things. And so that was really the problem that the city identified that they're wanting to address by looking at different alternatives they could do along NATO. And so we had the status quo before looking at alternatives. And then we had a few different alternatives. And these alternatives, this actually started as a student project here at Portland State, that we had a capstone project, your senior design kind of class, where they presented these different options and evaluated them with input from the city. And then we implemented on a trial basis the solutions that now have become a permanent solution for NATO. So one option was just saying, okay, let's make it really pedestrian and bike friendly. Cut the traffic down to one northbound, one southbound road, and then we have very expansive biking and pedestrian facilities there adjacent to the park. So that's an alternative. We'd look at the impacts. Well, what are the impacts of this? Obviously, by cutting the traffic capacity in half, that traffic is going to be diverted onto other roads. So we'd be studying the negative impacts as far as that, the capacity of the other roads to kind of absorb that influx of vehicle traffic. The pros here, certainly it is minimizing the pedestrian, bike, motorist interactions for the safety concern. Another option here was kind of a compromise where you got sort of two bike lanes here next to the Waterfront Park and a divider. You've got one northbound lane, two southbound lanes, et cetera. And so we looked at those various options, and then we did actually implement it on a trial basis where we just put up some simple dividers to kind of try it out without investing a lot of money. We got public feedback based on that sort of experimental trial run. And, that last option that we looked at really is kind of what's been installed. Got one northbound lane, two southbound lanes, big bike infrastructure here adjacent to the park. So that's just kind of an example of looking at a problem, identifying a problem, looking at various alternatives, this was a unique opportunity where we, were able to then sort of install it on a low scale, simple cost measure, get public feedback, and then decide it's worthwhile to make permanent. So one of the challenges on this planning phase for transportation is that, these projects take a long time to build and take a lot of money. And so it's kind of similar to the environmental discipline, where in the environmental discipline, you've got, a water treatment plant that you're trying to design for your city, that you've got to figure out, well, how much volume do we need? What's the population of our city? How much is it going to grow? We got to raise funds to build, money for the plant, etc. So any sort of public sector discipline is going to have similar needs and constraints. And so transportation sort of falls in that, where we're looking at, a couple decades in the future, that forecasting the infrastructure that we need. And to do that accurately, you really need to know what your population, how it's going to change over the next sort of 20, 30 years. You know, how is the city going to develop? You know, what, you know, are the effects of traffic pattern going to be so that we can, you know, adequately assess that? And, you know, one of the cool things here is that in many ways, you're participating in this process that you're getting to sort of design this vision and have some control on the future development of your city. You know, one of the things we've certainly experienced and noticed along Portland is that anywhere that we've kind of put up and chosen to like put streetcar or put sort of max lines, that there's always been some downstream effects as far as the economic sort of buildup along those regions just because of the volume of traffic, of people traffic that use those facilities. So we're looking at those sort of future traffic patterns, trying to sort of predict that, and it's kind of impossible to do. You know, trying to figure out, well, what's the technology, how's technology going to change? How's that going to impact our work commuting? That graph I gave earlier was a little bit from older times where people generally were going to the office 5 days a week. You know, pandemic obviously changed that. You know, now what's the new norm? What's the norm going to be, you know, 10 years from now? You're trying to sort of predict that. Technology as far as self-driving cars, you know, what else is in the realm of possibility? And you know, technology just changes so fast. It's a very dynamic and changing industry, which makes this process difficult, but also kind of exciting. You know, just to be involved in such a dynamic part of society. So something that's cool, a resource to sort of know about, is that all these are public projects, right? You know, these are going to be like DOTs across the country that are like doing this planning work. They've identified, okay, this is our vision. These are the problems we have. These are things we need to do to improve. And so generally speaking, you can go almost city by city across the country, and they have resources like this that, let's see if this opens for me. That you can go on to their website, let's see here, and see the projects that the city has identified and that they have planned in their budget or are planning for a future budget to do. So here's the city of Portland. This is the master transportation plan in map form for our city. And you can kind of click on any one of these, like, you know, over here, like this project here. This is a PBOT project. It's to design and implement bike facilities, and it's $13.5 million that they're doing along sort of Burnside Road there. The NA here, I think, means that I think all these purple projects are ones that are currently funded. So I think these are all sort of current projects that are in the sort of fiscal budget that are occurring. If you click on some of the blue projects over here, you can see that these have time frames associated with them. So these would be projects that are identified as a need, but either due to available funds that we just don't have the money in our current budget, or, you know, some other reasons, it's like, well, that's a priority, but it's not the highest priority. So it's on our radar, but we're planning for it. In this case, 11, 20 years out. You know, there's some other ones that are in the 1 to 10 year range, etc. Question, yeah?
Do you know if this map also shows right of way? Because I know this is a city where the team is looking for
this. This doesn't, so this is just kind of an overlay over, you know, like a Google Maps type thing. So this isn't showing specific right of way along roads, but just kind of identifying projects that have been either slated for the budget or are on the radar for future budgets, etc. The green ones on this map here, I think those are ones that are TriMet related projects. So, you know, here's a TriMet project, years 1 to 10. And all these have some general description about what the project is and an estimated cost for that. So it's kind of cool to know that resource is out there. You know, you can kind of go on this. The link is in the slide there. You can kind of see, like, you know, wherever you live, what are the projects that have been identified, things that are funded, things that aren't. And that can be a good resource to know that's there too, just on a civic action level, that if you think there's a big problem and you look here and you see that it's not identified or it's not funded, you know, that's something to perhaps talk to your city council members or representatives, you know, to try and get more public awareness to bring it into the master plan. But these are all kind of things that, you know, that planning department for the transportation disciplines are working with the city, working with, you know, the city and their budget, trying to come up with priorities as far as, you know, each of these types of projects, and then, you know, figure out what makes it to the current budget and what kind of gets pushed to the 1 to 10 year budget, etc. So another thing, just talking about, you know, how dynamic this industry can be and how quickly things change. How many people have ridden a scooter? You know, quite a few hands go up. So, you know, in 2018, like, scooters didn't exist in the city of Portland. Then they more or less popped up overnight. And they popped up overnight because these companies had applied for a pilot program where they're like, hey, we want to do this. And the city gave them a temporary permit to do that. And so almost overnight, these scooters popped up and people started driving around the city. And I think there was a period of 6 months here that they had their, a 4 month period from July to November that they had their initial permit. And so they popped up, they sort of were all over the city there for 4 months. And the city sort of collected data on that. And then November 20th came, their permit expired overnight, they disappeared. And then I think there was about a 6 month process where the city kind of solicited public meetings, got public input, figured out what worked well, what didn't work well, what sort of policies and rules and regulations should be in place for those. And then ultimately they then decided that with certain parameters in place, that it was a program that they wanted to then reissue permits. And so then I think the following summer of 2019, they issued more permits, and, you know, they obviously are part of our infrastructure again. But so it's just kind of cool to see how quickly technology is changing, and, you know, you look at the horizon as far as how technology is going to impact transportation sector of the next 10, 20 years, and it's going to be pretty dynamic. And it's kind of, you know, presents a lot of possibilities to improve society for the overall good, I think. So it's going to be exciting to be a part of. So that's the whole sort of planning side. Now, with those four stages in the transportation sector, with planning, where you're looking at a problem, identifying it, what various alternatives are. Once you've then identified the preferred alternative, this is what we want to do. And that's the one that goes to the design. So that design stage is going to go from sort of cradle to grave, you know, to produce the construction documents so that it can get built. For you know, these construction documents and these design are going to be for all the different types of infrastructure that we have. So it's certainly going to be for, you know, car-centric sort of traditional roadway design. It's going to be for railways. It's going to be for bike infrastructure. It's going to be for, you know, signaling and pedestrian crossings. All those sorts of things are sort of tied in here. Within the transportation office, often when you start out as a civil engineer, like a young engineer, often you get an opportunity to work on some planning projects, work on the design phase, you know, work under construction sort of phase, etc., and get sort of an experience, a spectrum of that process. And then, you know, some people like sort of jumping around, getting a little bit of both, a little bit of all the phases, and so that can be nice diversity in your work. Other people really kind of gravitate towards a certain area that, like, I just want to work on planning, just do that all the time. And so there's that possibility based on your interest that you can either kind of do a little bit of everything, or if you want to focus on one of the sectors, you can do that. For your traditional sort of roadway design, where you're looking at, let's say, car travel, you're looking at designing that to make it durable, so it's going to last, to make it safe, so that it's safe for whatever the mode of transport that's using it is. And so some of the considerations for that, for your typical roadway, you've got your existing grade as far as whatever that is, and then you're trying to design in the road grade that you're going to put in there. And so that typically involves lots of changing of grades. You're going to sort of smooth out that grade, bring in some dirt from certain parts of the project to put in, level it out in other parts. And so a whole big process to do that, balancing those earthwork, making sure the rates of change for either a horizontal curve or a vertical curve are safe with the speed of the roadway. So the slower the roadway, the more abrupt change you could have because you're not traveling at very fast speed. But if you've got like a freeway or something where you're going 70 miles an hour, then the rate of change you can have is much less, or it's not going to be safe. You're not going to have adequate sight distance to see a hazard ahead of you, be able to stop, things of that nature. So all that sort of very detailed in the design phase for that. You can either be designing on a big sort of roadway level, or just even on a simple intersection front. For a simple intersection front, you can look at anything from, how do you get traffic, through the intersection. And so one of the traditional ways is just to have a four-phase light interchange, where you've got, one phase for through traffic north-south, another phase for through traffic east-west, another phase for the left turns east-west, another phase for the left turns north-south. And so that obviously provides flexibility that people can either go straight, go make your turns, whatever it is, but it's less efficient because having four phases, you're going to have the other phases stopped at the stoplight waiting for the other phases to cycle through. And so another option when designing that interchange is to just have a two-phase light where you basically eliminate left turns. So you can either go straight or turn right, and then you just got two phases, one for north-south, one for east-west. And so you can get people through the intersection much faster without a bunch of backup. But you're impacting, the decision that it's not quite as flexible. And so, transportation engineers are looking at this, on an intersection by intersection as well as system level to try and figure out how to design the lights. And in particular, like in a downtown region like here in Portland, they've got the lights programmed for the different series of traffic flows that we get throughout the day. So there's a certain sequence that's in place for the morning commute, where you've got lots of people coming into the city, not a lot of people leaving. So it's programmed to get people efficiently into the city. And then they've got like a midday kind of like program for the interchanges. And then in the late afternoon, when you start to get that evening rush hour commute, then you've got a different program series of light changes to try and make it more efficient to get people out of the city. So all sorts of problems and design parts that engineers are working on. Also just looking at alternative intersection designs. So roundabouts is a emerging one that's really popular for a variety of reasons. If you've got a huge flow as far as volume of traffic, it's maybe not desirable. How many people have been in like a big traffic circle like in Paris or Brazil or somewhere that's just like crazy, like eight lanes of roundabout? They're a little scary, right? I've been in one in Beijing that was a little hairy. But, you know, if you don't have a large flow of traffic, you've just got single lanes coming in, this can actually be super efficient because you don't have to have traffic lights. And it's usually a safe means of intersection because people understand that they've got to merge, so they slow down. And so the speed of traffic going through the intersection is inherently less than if it's just a green light, people are flooring it going through the intersection. So the speed's safer, and you know, the traffic isn't super big volume, then you can often get through the intersection without any sort of real wait time, versus traffic light, you gotta wait for the sequence to go through. Yeah, so safety is more efficient, and you know, because it's more efficient, you're getting people through, you don't have cars just sitting there idling at the red light, which isn't as sustainable as well. All right, where's the biggest need for new roads or wider roads? Where do you think we need to build the most roads? Yeah, it's like where there's traffic, right? So where you've got lots of traffic, that's where all the demand is. That's where people are trying to get, you know, from point A to point B. They're trying to go through here. And, you know, we've all experienced a bottleneck, right, where you've got tons of traffic trying to get on I-5 or wherever. And, you know, some of the big ones in our region, we've got, you know, like the I-5 bridge. You've got, you know, a certain bottleneck there. You can't expand it very easily. And the bridge is what it is, how can we mitigate that problem? And when you focus just on a car-centric design in an urban region like this, it's really hard to fix this problem because inherently the data that people have studied shows that if you identify like, oh, here's a bottleneck, you know, we've got three lanes right here. If we just expand to a fourth lane, we increase the capacity by 33%. Should improve that. Well, inherently, usually what happens is you spend all this money, you get right away, you sort of expand that road, it's a couple year project, etc. Then finally you get that fourth lane, and for a period of about 2 months, usually traffic's better. But then over that 2 months, traffic adjusts based on the new norm, and you get back to the same sort of status quo you had before the project, where there's just more influx of traffic at that, you know, road that had the increased capacity, but then backs it up just as much as it was before. And so it doesn't really significantly affect in a long-term range improving the efficiency of the transportation network. And so for an urban center, really the best way, you know, as far as efficiency, moving people, you know, from an equity standpoint, as far as putting our big, expensive taxpayer dollars towards projects that serves everybody, not just serves a few, you know, it's much easier and much better to do that looking at other forms of transportation. It's not just car-centric. So public transit, buses, trains, you know, pedestrian, bike, etc. That's really where urban centers are, you know, trying to sort of invest more in those because it's more efficient with the money that you can improve facilities, improve safety, make it more equitable for all, make it more sustainable, etc. versus just keeping things car focused. So that can be a challenge for the transportation engineer because, you know, from a data standpoint, you can study that, you can learn that, you can sort of know that. But then you're always having that public interface where you might, as the transportation engineer, know that, like, hey, we need to put a rail line in here. We need to put a bus line in here. And that's what the data numbers, you know, suggest. That's what's going to be most cost effective, etc. But for the project to be a success, you have to have a public outreach component where you introduce the project, engage in that community dialogue, and ultimately get community buy-in. Because if you don't get that community buy-in, it's not going to be successful. And so again, that sort of just leads us to a much more dynamic kind of industry than some of the others, because for like a water line, you know, water, the environmental sector with like being publicly funded is kind of similar to this, but there's not quite the same public outrage or public opinion, if you will, about what you do with the water. People just want, you know, be able to turn the tap on, get clean water. That's what they want. They're not going to offer a lot of other insight. But how you design this intersection and what you do with traffic, you know, people are spending hours of their day in traffic, and everybody's got opinions about what you should do, right? And one of the things that people get most angry and most, you know, just emotional about is like traffic getting stuck. You know, it's just like everyone's got an opinion. That both makes it exciting and fun, but also a bit of a challenge. That, you know, as a structural engineer, people kind of defer to my advice. Like, make it safe. I want the bridge to hold up. Whatever it needs to be, it needs to be. They don't tell me how to do my job. Often, like on the transportation front, people are going to tell you how to do your job because they all have opinions and everybody thinks they know what's right. Okay, so next stage of the project's construction. So, you know, you've done that problem assessment, identified what you need to do. The design team has put together a series of drawings and specifications saying, here's the project. Then it goes to construction. And so that construction is going to be everything, you know, to do the grading, to do the foundation work, to do, you know, lay out the roadway. Always included with that, particularly in urban regions, you know, you typically have a intermediate construction phase of the project where you're having some negative traffic impacts. And so there's usually a traffic control plan. You know, how are you directing the flow of traffic during this construction phase, and how can you do it with the least negative impact possible? So that's always a big challenge. And one of the reasons why transportation projects always take so long is because, generally speaking, it's just not viable to shut down roads. And so if that's the status quo, that you can't shut down the road, you've got to keep it open, it makes the whole work process so much slower. Because, you know, most all the project work requires big, heavy equipment, lots of equipment in and out, and if you're keeping an active roadway open at the same time, it makes that slow. So, with that in mind, there are alternatives to that. And so again, you always have to look at alternatives and get sort of public buy-in. But one unique project I'll highlight here was in 2013, I-84, you know, from where it starts at I-5 to the 205 corridor, it was slated for repaving. You need to repave the whole 6 mile segment. And if they did it via traditional means would be shutting down one lane at a time. You know, so you put out all the cones, funnel traffic into the other two lanes, pave that one lane, then move things over, etc. That would have lasted sort of probably 6 months or longer to sort of do that whole process for both lanes, and had constant sort of daily effects as far as the traffic. And so what they did instead is they looked at that and they said, well, what's an option how we could do it more efficiently? And they identified 3 weekends of the summer. So they chose summer because summer weekends, there's less traffic. And so they said, okay, we're going to shut down the roadway from 10 p.m. Friday to 5 p.m. Monday, 3 weekends of the summer. We're going to only do the work in that time. So they're going to work continuously for that like 48-hour range. And by doing that, they paved and striped the entire roadway, all 6 miles, both directions, you know, by just having 3 weekends of impact versus continuous impact for months and months at a time. So I thought that was a pretty creative way to kind of look at the problem, assess how they could tackle it with the least impact and do it. Okay, so last phase of the project would be operation and maintenance. And so, you know, most of the other phases we've talked about, you know, are you can be involved in on the city side, or you can be involved in the transportation engineering firm design side. Once you get to the operation and maintenance side, that's generally more the city DOT facility that's sort of managing and maintaining those roadways and doing the maintenance. And the maintenance can vary, you know, from just simple striping of the roadway to, you know, repairing potholes to, you know, looking at intersections and the signals there and adjusting that timing, like I talked about, how you'll sort of adjust the timing to sort of get traffic in the morning, get traffic out in the evening, things of that nature. Adjusting that. So all that sort of varies, and yeah, you can be employed in a wide variety of employers there. So, are there any questions that come to mind, I guess, as far as the disciplines and the phases and the types of projects with transportation?
Yeah. I always feel like people are talking about like the I-5 bridge, either like reconstruction or something along those lines. Do you think the method would be that? Would they be able to build it alongside, or would they tear down
the bridge? Yes. So it's been a constant. So I moved to Portland in 2002, and basically in the 20-some years I've lived here, it's been a constant topic of discussion as far as doing that. And there are lots of different ways. I mean, so we have built some bridges in Portland in that 20 years I've been here. One of the more recent ones was the Selwood Bridge. And the Selwood Bridge, what they did when that was rebuilt, they had the old roadway bridge that was kept open during construction. Adjacent to it, they built the new bridge, and then they had some way that they kind of demoed and moved it into place kind of thing. So like this cool kind of operation they did that. And so, yeah, there's always a huge kind of process to sort of design and sort of figure out how you do that. My understanding for this would be based on the old Columbia Crossing plan that was the I-5 bridge is shared between Oregon and Washington. It's an interstate, so it's federal roadway. And if you're not familiar with the history, they're actually probably about a decade or more ago, there was an improved plan in place to replace the bridge, and we had gotten federal funds to do it. State of Oregon had voted and approved it, and state of Washington voted it down. And if they voted it down largely because of Clark County opposition, pushed kind of the roadway down. And the reason why Clark County opposed it was because the federal government would not provide any money for the plant, for the bridge, unless we had mass transit, meaning rail, to the city of Vancouver. And the city of Vancouver thought that would bring, you know, crime and different things to the city, and that's why the politicians killed the project. And since we then didn't have both states in agreement to fund it, the project was canned. Federal government then said, hey, we've given all this money to you to fund this project. You're not building the project, you owe those funds back to us. So it's been this sort of big litigation process as well. Finally, due to, you know, the need hasn't gone away. It's still a huge, huge problem along the whole I-5 corridor that spans from Mexico to Canada. I think this is the worst bridge in the entire, you know, 1,000+ miles of roadway along I-5. So it's a huge need from a national perspective. And so there is finally a working group in place again. They have, you know, buy-in on both Washington and Oregon side, and so it is moving forward. But I think that the new bridge is going to be have a slightly different alignment than the existing one, so that they'll build the new one fully, be able to keep the old one in place, and then they basically have like a big sort of, road curve sort of connecting the road on the north and south sides, that the final stages, they'll do that connection, and then once they do that connection to open up the new one, they'll demo the old one. But yeah, it's a cool, exciting sort of process, figure out how to do that, how to stage it, et cetera. Other questions? Cool. Well, I'll go ahead and stop there, and then on Wednesday we've got the alumni roundtable, so come with questions. I'll send out a link with LinkedIn profiles for the alumni, so you can kind of look them up beforehand. And yeah.